bouncers and the drug dealers and the drug addicts and the villains and the gangsters are entitled to hear the gospel of Jesus.
Former criminal Alan Mortlock is, so he says, an evangelist to the underworld. He's now a North London boxing promoter who claims 14 years ago, God's word saved him from a life of crime.
I love fighting. I was a street fighter, and the trouble that I got into was violence, even at an early age.
And what do you go to prison for?
Causing an affray, malicious wounding, and two assaults.
Someone give me six.
Hardly you'd think a man of God. But that was about to change. In December 1990, Alan had a vision.
In the middle of whatever time it was, I woke up, and as I woke up, to the right of my bedroom, I could see a grey cloud of smoke. And in the mist, I saw the eyes, the nose and the mouth of a man looking down at me. He frightened the life out of me, and I've got to be honest with you, I've had a 38 Smith & Wesson gun in my temple with a man's hand shaking like this. So I looked at the hand and I thought to myself, I hope he don't sneeze, because if he sneezes, he's going to blow my head right off my shoulders. Yet what was happening in my bedroom phased me out even more, because I knew it was from the supernatural.
From that day on, the Bible became the most important book in Alan's life. But what about my research in Rome on the Gospels? Does Alan really need to read them as historical record?
The Bible, to me, is the handbook. It is the highway code of life. And I believe that if you want to learn about life and how you should lead your life and how you should deal with people and how the Bible also is a book of power that can help you as a person, to me, that Bible is the book of my handbook of life.
Who wrote the Bible for you? Was it God or man?
God. Yeah, it was God. Man wrote it down in the physical, but to me, I believe that God was the inspiration that spoke to them, man. It's God's word. The Bible, to me, is God's word.
Does that mean when you read the New Testament, you read it as the literal word of God?
The literal word of God.
Yeah. So you'd believe that, for example, Matthew was a disciple who wrote down what he saw?
I believe so, yeah, I believe so, yes.
What if I was to say to you that they were written down years, decades after the life of Jesus and not eyewitness accounts?
That night in my house, God showed me and come into me and showed me that he was real. Now, if the Bible, which I believe is God's word, I believe that Matthew is exactly where he says he was at that time. And it wouldn't matter to me, and I'm not disrespectful to the professors and all that, but it wouldn't matter what they said. To me, they were there at that time.
All right, work. Come on, work.
I'd never knock Alan's faith. Whichever way you look at it, he's been saved for sure. But you wonder whether these problems of authorship have provoked any soul-searching in the upper ranks of the Anglican Church, people like the Bishop of Durham.
Bishop Tom. For you, who wrote the Bible?
The Bible is, of course, a human book constructed by men and women, but equally, Christians have always said it's a divine book in that God intended them to write what they did, and that, of course, plunges you straight into the middle of the classic theological question as to how humans and God are both responsible for the same thing at the same time, and that's, as with Jesus being both human and divine, that's one of the oldest mysteries in the book.
If none of the writers are eyewitnesses, doesn't that undermine their authority and credibility?
I think even if none of the Gospels were actually written by eyewitnesses, we can certainly track back very easily and effectively to the real Jesus. We often forget how oral cultures work because we live in a print culture, a mass media culture, and in their sort of culture, the sort of stories that people tell, particularly when they're life-changing stories, they tell them again and again and again and again until they're deeply part of the fabric of who they are, and then a whole community tells those stories and bang, you've got large connected narratives that actually everybody knows.
It seems to me that what you're saying is that when you read it, therefore, you're reading it as being truthful and accurate. So Jesus, when we're told Jesus walks on the water, for you that's real.
And I'm not sure what the word real means, because it's a slippery word. Yes, I'm perfectly happy to say that it happened. I'm also, because I basically believe that God can do whatever God wants to do. And of course our culture has balked at some of that. We won't believe in somebody walking on the water. Well, that's our bad luck. We've got to do business with what's there.
Each writer has a perspective, an angle, sometimes an axe to grind. Is it fair to say that what they're doing is spinning the gospel?
All writers write from a perspective, from a point of view, just like if you set up a video camera to record every single thing that happens on the street, you may see something that's exciting. The chances are most of what you see will be really rather boring and tedious and humdrum. So, of course, there's selecting and arranging. And if you want to call that spin, fair enough, as long as you realise that it's what we all do all the time. In other words, this is not a devious, cunning manipulation of events. They're telling the story in such a way as to bring out the flavour, to bring out the meaning. And, OK, it's the meaning that they see, but that does not mean that the things didn't happen or that Jesus never said it. It's really time to grow up beyond this rather sterile either-or of either it was just a snapshot at the time or somebody made it up later. It's much richer than that.
Strong words. But surely this cast-iron belief that the Bible is above reproach owes a lot to the awesome authority of the book itself. And I can't help wondering how that's come about. This is one of the major print works for Bible production in Britain today, a far cry from the 2nd century AD, when thousands of scribes copied the original scrolls of the New Testament Gospels or letters over and over again. The only way of publishing back then. But a bigger leap than all this machinery is the fact that today the Bible is a single book with a definitive list of chapters and a fixed order, always the same.
I think most people would be deeply shocked and surprised to find out that the Bible just doesn't appear as a book. After all, it's holy scripture, and holy usually means that it drops out of the sky or it drips off the mouth and tongue of God. But the real shocker is the fact that about 200 years after Jesus, there aren't just four Gospels and the other books that make up the New Testament, but literally dozens of Gospels and dozens of letters, all with different interpretations of events and all jockeying for a position. So, in terms of compiling the Bible, there's still a long way to go from having lots of texts written on papyri in different languages to ending up with the Bible, a modern-day bestseller with a shiny front cover, available for people to read in English at a store near you.
Not that everyone had the chance to read scripture back then, with only 10% literacy.
We still must remember that most people throughout this whole period would be hearing the Bible read out. And the scholars would be reading it and studying it, and the preachers and so on. But the people would be hearing them read, not accessing the book themselves. Individual leaders in certain cities have the power of being the main teaching bishop in that city to teach the Bible and instruct people in which parts of the Bible they recognise and which they don't.
This way, a kind of consensus was evolving about what was scripture. Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, of course, the letters of Paul and so on. But behind the scenes, various bishops were also working hard to suppress or discredit anything they saw as heresy. Dangerous views from the margins. Then, in the early 4th century AD, a technological development helped settle the New Testament canon or list of books.
In this period, you've got a transition from papyrus to parchment, to leathers, animal skins. Much more able to produce big books. So that plays a very important part in gathering together things into a single volume.